Good morning, colleagues, and welcome to the 12th meeting in 2017 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. Can I give apologies on behalf of Neil Bibby? And I ask members also to switch off their mobile phones or at least put them in a mode that won't interfere with their proceedings. The only item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Scottish approach to taxation with a particular focus on incorporations. And we're joined for that purpose by Charlotte Barbour, who's the Director of Taxation at ICAS, Alex Cobham, who is the Chief Executive of the Tax Justice Network, John Cullinane, who is the Tax Policy Director of the Chartered Institute of Taxation, and Richard Murphy from the Director of Tax Research UK. A very warmly welcome all of our witnesses to help us in the proceedings this morning. And I just want to kick the proceedings off and we'll go to Marie, who's going to kick off the proceedings. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning and welcome. I just wondered, there's obviously been a change in the level of incorporation in the UK as a whole over the last few years. Some of it because of tax planning and some of it probably because precipitated by the financial crash in 2008, where many people were lost their employment and became self-employed. I just wondered if you folks have any evidence at all on whether that change is levelling off or whether it's likely to continue and grow. I know there's been some recent changes from the UK government in terms of dividends and things, so is that likely to impact on the level of incorporation in future?
Evidence to hand, but I think the Office of Budget Responsibility, you know, at the UK level, did project that the trend was likely to continue. And clearly the change that the Chancellor made to dividend tax in the last UK budget was intended to kind of try and reduce that. But if you look at the effective marginal rates of tax on incorporated versus unincorporated business even after that change, it hasn't levelled it up. It's probably moved, you know, depends on the income level and all sorts of other things, but it's probably moved about one quarter in the direction of levelling it up. So I think it's kind of unlikely that of itself it will stem that flow.
And there's one feel free to contribute if you wish.
I'd add that as long as your rates are different, I quite like the way the Institute of Fiscal Studies paper discusses all this problem, and I think they've got some interesting statistics in their paper. And as they rightly say, you're at the kind of confluence of income tax, corporation tax, and national insurance. And my reading of it in broader terms is that as long as there's differentials, people are always wanting to save tax. Well, not all people always, but the majority tend to want to minimise their costs around there. So as long as there's differentials, then I think incorporations, for instance, might continue to apply because it's cheaper, ultimately.
I have studied this data and written a couple of papers on it. The change in the incorporation pattern in the UK happened when Gordon Brown introduced a 0% effective start rate for corporation tax, which was in 2000 or 2001 from memory. And at that point, we had 1.5 million companies in the UK, and now we're on about 3.8 million. Now, that does not mean they're all the same. The turnover is quite phenomenal. A very large number of companies in the UK last four or fewer years in their life. Quite a significant number lasts less than 2 years, which may well indicate a pattern of tax evasion, by the way, because I think they're extensively used for tax evasion, which is a much bigger issue than the differential on the rates. But that pattern of using companies for tax planning really started in about 1986-87, when National Insurance first encouraged incorporation and the payment of dividends, which it did from then on. It was a well-known pattern throughout that period and simply became more attractive under various rule changes that have happened until the dividend tax came in. The dividend tax will not change that, as John shall quite correctly say. There remains a differential. It still is cheaper to incorporate and pay yourself by dividends than it is to trade as a sole trader or as a partnership or as an LLP, and therefore incorporation remains for tax purposes attractive. But I don't think that's the only reason. I think we have artificial disguised employments now being run through companies, and there's an enormous pressure from many companies to actually have their disguised employees incorporate, so that does create an incentive for incorporation as well. These are not genuinely trades, these are simply people who are being exploited by the employer as much as they are exploiting the tax system. And we are seeing significant patterns of tax abuse through companies as well.
I'll just add on that last point, and I think the difference that we've seen, if you talk to people in the financial services sector, for example, is a switch from people setting up companies to get their, to take their income because their mates are doing it and you're seeing it in the sector, to a refusal to employ people other than through a company structure. So we've kind of locked it in. It's become a systemic behaviour, which I think is much harder to unravel than changing the incentives of individuals if it's the employers themselves who are demanding this, as they often are in financial services in Edinburgh, for example. How you unravel that, I think, is a different kind of problem from how you change the decisions individuals might make about how aggressive to be on their own avoidance. And that's, you know, the kind of thing I think comes back to policymakers much more clearly.
One step, I think we're discussing two slightly different things. Your point there, there is a situation where people have been employees or are employees, and I think the elephant in the room is probably national insurance because employers find that expensive. And then if you amalgamate it with employment rights and other things like that, there's a question as to whether you can have those employees, if that's the word for it, costing less, and then you take them off payroll. Disguised remuneration, those kind of situations. And those kind of people, you get them at the bottom end of this pay scale and you get them at the top end of the pay scale. And that's one sector of people that we might want to look at. And then there's a completely different sector where you're running a genuine business, an accountancy practice, making widgets, doing whatever you do. And you know, if you start up, you start up and you just work on your own and you get on with it. And you reach a stage where you think, is this the way to go about things? And you might stay on sole trader or partnership, which is in income tax, or as you get bigger, you tend to be encouraged to head towards corporation tax and incorporating. And a company is a part of that package and the overall decision. But they are slightly distinct, and you are looking at slightly different sectors of people. And then maybe the other rider that we should put in here is that this is a UK problem. Anything that we do here in Scotland is an element that interacts with it. It's not a Scottish problem as such.
Thank you very much. And on that note, on the particular challenges for the Scottish Parliament, I wanted to ask you all another fairly general question. So clearly income tax was not fully devolved to Scotland. There are limits. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on the limits in terms of which aspects of income tax were devolved. And you mentioned there, Charlotte, the confluence between the other forms of taxation that people might face, so corporation tax, dividend tax, national insurance. What limits does that provide for the Scottish Government in terms of altering income tax when they have no control over all those others?
There is a specific, I think, problem with for Scotland with the devolved regime in this regard, that you know, what you've got control over is the main income tax rate, which is what you will, which is the main tax you will pay if you are a self-employed sole trader. Whereas, obviously, corporation tax hasn't been devolved, and neither has the dividend tax rate. So, if you've got these two choices, incorporated or unincorporated, you know, one side will be heavily, if it's in Scotland, one side will be heavily influenced by what the Scottish Parliament does, whereas the other side won't be influenced at all under current rules. So it's, you know, it's difficult for you to think about how, in the Scottish context, you kind of balance that up without some idea of either without a change in the rules or without some idea of what the UK is going to do.
You probably have as much flexibility with income tax as the UK Parliament does, and is really politically driven, isn't it, as to how much you can raise rates or how much you can lower rates versus spending. And I don't think that the devolution of income tax rates and bans gives you huge, you know, can you have a radical approach to Scottish taxation? Well, yes, you can. But in political, practical terms, I don't think around income tax there's as much flexibility as it would initially look, or in relation to the amounts of money that actually come in here.
There are a number of areas where, well, let me be honest, I agree with John and Charlotte with regard to the practical current constraints to some degree. But let's look at what those mean and what that actually also implies. First of all, let's go back to incorporation. Scotland has a dire record on incorporation. According to the records of Companies House, which admittedly is in Wales, there have been no prosecutions in Scotland under Scottish law for breaches of the Companies Act since 2008. In those terms, Scotland isn't the Wild West, Scotland is the Wild North. Why there is no enforcement of company law in Scotland is a good question, and one which I think you might want to follow up, because that appears to be the case. Now, maybe the prosecutions are under other law, but perhaps they're just not taking place at all. And the number of prosecutions anyway is tiny. So let's also put this in the context of the fact that Scotland does not appear to be enforcing the law that exists with regard to the submission of company accounts. And my research shows that companies that don't submit company accounts also don't submit company tax returns. Let's put that in context. At least 1 million of the companies that are in existence each year in the UK do not submit corporation tax returns. 600,000 of those are by consent of HMRC, because when a company is incorporated, it is sent a form, and that form says, does your company trade? And if you tick the box saying no, you get a letter back from the revenue saying, thank you very much, we'll contact you in 5 years. Most people take that as an invitation to make no declaration. So there is a procedural change that can be made straight away in Scotland, if you so wish to discuss this with Revenue Scotland, about changing that approach and demanding a corporation tax return from every company that has a registered office in Scotland, for example, what would be one way of tackling this issue and trying to collect the tax that is not paid. The second one would be demanding that the Scottish Register of Companies, and of course there is a Scottish Register, does actually insist that the accounts that are due are filed, because that does not appear to be the case at present. So I think there is a lot that can be done at the basic level of incorporation in Scotland, because there is Scottish law on this issue which needs to be looked at, and administrative practices need to be reformed. Then you're in the problem that, in fact, tax systems do not work in the way that devolution has taken place on taxation affairs. Nobody in the real world of accountancy, and I'm a chartered accountant as well as an academic and so on now, but I'm still a practicing chartered accountant. In the real world, you think about tax systems as a whole. You have been devolved some very small parts of a total tax system with which you can do very little, bluntly. What you can do very often will actually end up making it look as though you've made things worse, because that's the way it was designed to be, I suspect. What you cannot do is actually play between the interaction between income tax and national insurance, and yet that is key with regard to this issue of incorporation, because you don't have power over national insurance, which makes little sense because it's the easiest tax to devolve, because it's easier to identify where employees are than just about anything else. You can't play with the difference between income tax on earnings and income tax on non-earned sources, and yet in this current situation of incorporation, quite clearly somebody can opt in or out of Scottish taxation by choice now. If they decide to pay themselves a salary from their company, they're within the scope of Scottish income tax, and if they decide to pay a dividend, they're not. We could not have come up with a more absurd tax system for Scotland than that. So, frankly, my suggestion is you need to go back to the negotiation table as soon as possible after the 8th of June and say, can we have a better settlement? I mean, whoever, whatever the future is, whatever the party is, you have been left with a very poor foundation for this.
Yes, that will spark off a few supplementary questions. But thank you, Richard. Adam.
Can I just take you back to the point about enforcement to make sure that I've understood it correctly? Is your claim that there have been no prosecutions against companies incorporated in Scotland under UK companies law, or is your claim that there have been no prosecutions since 2008, or is your claim that there have been no prosecutions specifically in the Scots courts, notwithstanding the fact that this is a reserved company law, is a reserved area of the law?
I'm working on the basis of the information supplied by Companies House, which has consistently said since 2008 there is no data on any prosecutions in Scotland under company law.
Okay, but so
it may be wrong, but that's what they keep on telling me, and I keep on asking them, and I don't get any other information.
Do you ask the follow-up question as to whether there are prosecutions brought against companies located in Scotland in the courts in London, which is where I would expect those prosecutions to be brought?
I have not asked that question,
right,
though.
Okay, thank you.
But I don't actually understand why that would be the case. They tend to try and bring the prosecutions in the area where the registered office is.
It may be for reasons of legal expertise in the relevant courts.
It may be. But it would still be surprising that Scotland has no legal expertise in that case. I would still raise that question.
Okay. Any other supplementaries in that area before I move on to some of the more behavioural stuff that was underlining some of these questions? Right, Murdo.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I wanted to, I mean, it's really a follow-on from some of Marie Todd's questions about, look at the question of behavioural change, and maybe start with yourself, John Cullen, because you mentioned this in your written submission. What we've seen is the Scottish Government deciding to go down a different path in terms of income tax for higher earners. That's had a major impact in the current financial year. It'll have a more significant impact as we get towards 2020-2021 if we continue the current trajectory. To what extent do you think that change, that differential in terms of income tax rates between Scotland and the rest of the UK, is likely to drive behaviour change in terms of taxpayers, and would, for example, that be likely to lead to more higher earners in Scotland going down the incorporation route?
Well, I think it's very important. I mean, anytime anybody wants to put up a tax or lower a threshold, then the obvious kind of response is, oh, well, you know, people will vote with their feet in various ways. And it's, I think, quite important to try and get as much evidence as you can as to, you know, to what extent that is in fact the case, because it's all about, you know, how much. I think it is actually very difficult to say, to be honest, because even if you look at the UK level, when the rate went up from 45 to 50%, you know, it was there for about 2 years. And a lot of the evidence of what behavioural adjustment there was really around temporary adjustments of people managing to postpone dividends at one, accelerate dividends at one end or postpone them at the other. So there's a difference between temporary effects around the change and a sort of ongoing effect. You do hear a lot of people saying, well, you know, I could go and work in England if you're close to the border or whatever. I'm not sure when the rate in the UK level went up to 50%, there was really as many of the kind of permanent ongoing reactions as was trailed. But then again, it was in for such a short time. I mean, of all the different reactions you can think of, that, you know, if it's there for a long time and it's expected to continue or deepen or widen, you know, the difference between Scotland and the rest of the UK, you know, you might expect at the margin some, you know, investment decisions affected. You might find people looking out more. But of all the various ways and means that people might go about, you know, trying to get out of an effectively higher tax burden, I would have thought the incorporation route would be the one that was most likely to be taken, because if, as Charlotte was saying, if you're a growing business, it's an issue that comes up anyway and for reasons of legal protection and a whole lot of other reasons besides tax. So it's kind of on the agenda anyway for a certain type of taxpayer. And, you know, there is evidence over a long period, and again, you know, Richard was saying, going back to the beginning of the century at the UK level, of you know, of people reacting to a lower tax burden in that route elsewhere. So, you know, of all the various ways and means that, or behavioural response that might come about, it's one of the kind of easiest to see that it might happen. But that's sort of hunch, to be honest, or is based loosely on just historical evidence at the UK level in the last few years. I mean, you know, one of the problems is getting the direct evidence. You know, by the time you've got it in and assessed it, you're sort of 5 years down the track, you know, with the issue. It's actually quite a difficult problem.
The underlying dynamic here, I think, is worth thinking about, which is that politically, it is always very appealing to talk of competition. And that talk goes well beyond any evidence in favour of it. And I think the risk that presents here is exactly that, in a sense, the ideological lure of thinking that you're competing on tax by cutting is not borne out by the evidence. But as John says, you go a long way down the road, you give up a lot before you find that. So if we look at the UK at the moment, you know, the extremely ill-advised moves on corporation tax, cutting the statutory rate, the government has continued year upon year with a policy which its own analysis, never mind that of the Office of Budget Responsibility, shows will have a predicted effect of zero in terms of increasing investment or increasing the tax base. In other words, they're making this decision to put cut beyond cut beyond cut on the basis of their own analysis showing this is a pure giveaway with no expected economic benefit. And yet the rationale, the justification rather, given is this one of the most competitive tax rate. Now, that sounds in some sense appealing, but without the evidence behind it, it is a very extreme position taken. The risk when you have, you know, as Richard was saying, very fragmented tax powers, only a part of the overall picture, is that that type of political demand may be relatively appealing. So the prospects of falling towards a race to the bottom, evidence aside, are probably rather greater than the prospects for, with the narrow powers that exist, being able to take on the more progressive taxation, which there is a clear public demand for, both here and in the rest of the UK. So the position I think you face is one where, you know, you have an unfortunate choice between trying to pursue something more progressive that does reflect public demands here, but is difficult and perhaps impossible to deliver within the limits on the powers you have, while facing, on the other hand, this risk that actually potentially there is more likelihood of falling into a race to the bottom. And for that reason, you know, you see in the European Union, for example, things like the state aid rules very early on put in place to try and limit the competition between different jurisdictions. For that reason, all things being equal, you probably wouldn't want to see a further splintering of tax powers. But obviously the political context may well be one that demands it, because the divergence between public views here and political positioning in Westminster may become an irresistible case for further devolution of tax powers.
There are a couple of evidential sources which suggest that incorporation is easy in the sense of an existing source of income. I mean, and we know that. I don't actually think that the changes in Scottish tax rates really increase the attractiveness of incorporation, frankly, at the moment. That trend is already there. There is very little evidence that it will change that very much. What there is evidence on is that people will not actually fundamentally change their lives for taxation. So whilst incorporation is easy, moving for tax is something that very, very few people actually do. It was widely discussed that a lot of people would leave London, for example, and go to Switzerland in 2010 because of the onset of a 50% tax rate. And there was actually thought to be one very easy measure of this, which was demand for places in English language schools in places like Geneva. The demand actually went down rather than up, which was quite interesting. There was no surge of people leaving London for that reason. The number of tax exiles is tiny. And there's been quite a lot of research done in the USA where there are lots of tax borders, which makes, therefore, research a lot easier. And there's no disincentive to moving across a state border because of cultural and other changes. And it's been found that people will not move 20 miles to reduce their tax rate. So in some states where there's an income tax of up to 8%, and in the neighbouring state there's no income tax at all, there might be a sales tax, but you can overcome that by moving back to the state you just came from. So there's massive opportunities for arbitrage. People will not move, lift their children out of their schools, leave the golf club, whatever it might be, to actually save tax. Those things are much more important than tax. You know, much as I think tax is important, you know, I wrote a book, The Joy of Tax. Shameless plug. But it isn't that important to people after all.
Could I perhaps add that I think one needs to be careful that we don't overemphasise this point on incorporation, because about 85% of people pay income tax are employees. And we know in Scotland all our kind of figures for self-employment are slightly lower than in the rest of the UK. So and it's not as though you can just automatically flip out of employment into a company. It's not as simple as that, and there's plenty of barriers to it from a whole host of reasons, including, you know, psychological ones and behavioural ones and employment ones and all the rest of it. So I think we need to be careful that we don't get too too caught up in that one. It's a factor that you need to be aware of, but it's not the be all and end all. And the other thing that I might perhaps draw attention to is that in looking at the different powers that Scotland has, I accept that, you know, in income tax, we only have part of the toolkit, and we don't have national insurance or corporation tax, but that doesn't mean that the glass has to be half empty. It could mean, for instance, that you still got control over the amount of income tax that comes in, and it might be, we've discussed it quite a bit at work recently, that you'll start to see a pull apart from income tax and national insurance. For decades, we've all argued that there's six or one and a half a dozen, they're just a tax on income. But actually, if one has become a kind of devolved matter and one a reserved matter, there is the possibility that they'll start to pull apart more.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. I mean, it's actually a very interesting discussion because it sounds like what you're all saying is that the behavioural drive towards greater incorporation is likely to be only a very marginal impact and no greater in Scotland than any other part of the UK, if that's a reasonable summary of what I think your position is. Yeah, you're agreeing with that. Okay, can I ask maybe it's a slightly different question?
I'm not sure I totally agree with that. Okay. I agree with all the comments of my colleagues about, don't think tax drives everything. But I do think if you're self-employed and you've got a growing business, incorporation is—it's not like moving your kids out of school. Incorporation is on the agenda anyway. And I also agree with the comments that were made earlier that if you're a maybe large company trying to force down your employment costs and thinking it's a nice idea to get people off the payroll, once you've done that, you won't leave them as self-employed contractors. You'll say to them, you set up a company so that I can deal with the company, because then it is believed safer against an audit by HMRC as to the employment status, because you're paying a company. Now it's not actually as simple as that, but I think the two phenomenons are quite closely related. And if you look at the last UK budget, there was the national insurance change that was withdrawn, which was all about the imbalance between tax on employment and self-employment. And you've got the dividend tax change. Those were the two biggest measures, really. So it clearly is concerning policymakers, at UK level, even with all the concerns about Brexit and so on. So I think those are probably two of the biggest issues for the UK tax system, at the moment. I mean, not that the world will fall apart if it's not fixed, but I think those are threats to the UK tax base that are likely to continue for some foreseeable time, because it's not obvious how the imbalances are going to be resolved. And I agree that the extra Scottish dimension probably isn't significant at the moment, but it's a kind of unhelpful feature that you've got control over one side of the equation but not control over the other. So that it's a bit of a specific warning light for Scotland, even though it's not a Scottish problem.
In a slightly different area.
Well, it follows up very neatly on what John Collins just said, because I wanted to just ask about this question of alignment between employment and self-employment and incorporation, which you've just touched on, which of course was something that the Chancellor tried to address in the budget, and such was the reaction. He then had to make a swift retreat from that. I mean, how realistic do you think it is that a government is able to bring about this alignment, given the political backdrop?
Well, at one level, one could be even more pessimistic than that, because the change he was trying to bring about was really tiny compared to the size of the imbalance. And as one of my colleagues said, I'm not sure they use this expression, but the kind of elephant in the room is employers' national insurance. If you compare a situation of an employer or an engager, to try and use a more neutral term, employing somebody versus taking on a self-employed contractor, if they can actually lawfully and properly do that, the biggest element in the equation is employers' national insurance, which is over 13% of payroll. So that's a clear, driver, for employers to seek to minimise their employment costs. The one thing I would say that's more, hopeful really is, the UK has this terrible tradition of budget surprises. You know, it would almost be a disappointing budget unless you produce several rabbits from a hat. So the chance, so if you were a self-employed person and facing a, you know, a couple of percent extra national insurance over a couple of years, probably you'd have first heard about it on News at 10, you know, that night. You wouldn't have, there wouldn't have been a big warm-up of a government consultation to say, look, you know, we've, you know, it's nobody's fault, as it were, but we've got this huge imbalance in the tax system. What are the options for doing something about it? There's, you know, no attempt to do that. You just sort of spring a surprise, and then you are yourself surprised when there's a kind of very adverse and to some degree sort of slightly ill-informed and hysterical sort of reaction. You know, we in the Chartered Institute certainly believe that if there was a much more thoroughgoingly consultative approach, you could engender a much better public debate. And obviously no one's ever going to, I don't know if they're ever going to view it as joyful to pay tax, but they, you know, I think people are realistic. I mean, if you look at things like the increase in the, you know, state retirement age, you know, that has been over the last few years, I mean, people haven't rioted in the streets about that. People can accept unpopular or difficult things, but they need to kind of understand the reasons, and time needs to be taken, and there needs to be debate. And I think that's probably the main lesson that comes out, to try and move away from these terrible, you know, surprise budget measures.
Mm. And Richard?
You're hinting at one of the key issues which you has been suggested should be a basis for Scottish taxation, which is, of course, the ability to pay. But in this sense, alignment requires that a person on the same level of income should pay the same level of tax. That's one of the fundamental principles. Horizontal equity is necessary within a tax system if you're also to deliver vertical equity, which is what proportionality requires. And that is going right back to Adam Smith. There are a large number of threats within the UK tax system to that alignment. One is obviously this issue of incorporation versus employment versus self-employment. I actually think that there are good reasons why the self-employed do not pay as much tax as the employed. I have been self-employed and employed. I'm in the curious position of currently being employed after 35 years of self-employment. And the novelty of having somebody putting money into my bank account at the end of every month without having to send them an invoice, threaten them with legal action or anything else, is really quite amazing. I enjoy it enormously. The difference is staggering. Let me assure you, being self-employed is not the same thing. So I do actually see some reason for non-alignment there, because the risk profile is genuinely different. But we do have many other areas of non-alignment, and I'll go back to some of the issues that are important. For example, and I go back to tax evasion, and that is very important here as well. The OECD has just issued a paper in the last 2 weeks pointing out the massive imbalance in a society where the tax authority does not pursue tax evasion with the right amount of vigour. I don't believe the UK does. I believe there is a massive understatement by HMRC of the scale of tax avoidance and tax evasion in the UK economy. The fact that a million companies don't submit corporation tax returns a year suggests to me that there's an negligence, and I'll use the word quite carefully. I'm suggesting there is negligence on their part with regard to the administration of corporation tax, and that they do not pursue that issue properly. When I checked how many of the penalties for non-submission of corporation tax returns were collected, in 1 year, I think it was 2011, 99.9% of the penalties were not collected, which shows it's pretty meaningless exercise to issue them in the first place. They're just not doing their job. And the OECD has argued that this could increase productivity by 1%, as well as obviously improving the tax shield. And the reason for productivity is it provides a level playing field between the cheats and those who are honest. And that's a most critical alignment. If you believe that the private sector is a foundation of the economy, then to actually treat it with respect by collecting tax from those who are cheating is a fundamental principle to taxation, I would suggest. So this is another part of horizontal equity that is essential. But at the moment, we haven't got that horizontal equity. It could be created, but it can't be created by the dividend tax either, because the dividend tax is only on one source of investment income and targeted very specifically at dividends, clearly, from incorporated entities. Let's put this in context, going back to the numbers that John was talking about with regard to this abuse. We may be talking at a loss in the UK tax system of 3 to 4 billion as a result of incorporation at the present point of time. That is a half of 1% of UK taxation. Now, I'm not saying that isn't an issue, But let's put it in its context. There are other more important issues, perhaps, where we should be looking for alignment. Clearly, rental income, which is now encouraged to be put into companies because of the changes in tax relief on borrowing, is another area where it may well be essential to create alignment as well. So the question of alignment just between incorporation and self-employment or whatever is not the only issue to be looked at. There are many more before you can create a tax system which accords with this principle of proportionality.
I'm sensing there's nobody else going to respond. Ivan, you've got a supplementary on this.
Yeah, thanks, convener, and thanks, panel, for the discussion so far. There was a couple areas I want to touch on, both things we've looked at already. The first was round about the differential income tax bans in Scotland now and the behavioural impact that might drive. And I welcome some of the comments you've made on the unimportance to a large extent of those small differentials in behavioural change. And I suppose if you look at that tax differential amounts to about £400 per year and affects 10 to 15% of the taxpaying population. Now, I was then thinking, well, it'd be nice if we had some evidence of another tax differential of about £400 that affected people. And of course, we've had that in place in Scotland for a number of years now, and it affects a much larger number of people, which, of course, is the council tax differential. And I just wonder if you'd like to comment on whether you've seen any evidence of people moving from England to Scotland to save £400 on their council tax. And following on from that, talking about, obviously, another impact, there could be businesses deciding where it's set up. And I've been in the position on several occasions, spending other people's money and my own money deciding where to set manufacturing businesses up across Europe. And I can tell you, certainly in my experience, and I'd like your comment on that as well, the differential in income tax is well down the list of things you look at. You look at logistics, supply chain, whether you're in a single market, availability of skilled labour, where your suppliers are, etc., etc., etc. So again, I would be interested if you've got any comments on that as well before I move on to the second part of my question, which was about incorporations.
Will I come back on that initially?
Yes,
I agree with you. You don't hear a lot of people really doing much about £400 difference in the income tax. Do you know, we all need something to grumble about, and there's one of the things. What and I've no statistical evidence on this, but what I do hear a lot more in terms of kind of general comment is not specifically income tax, but say the council tax change is increasing, LBTT being slightly higher, and as I say, it's only anecdotal evidence, but the suggestion would be that rather than looking at taxes in isolation, it's maybe the overall package. And then coming to your second point about businesses, yes, I agree, tax isn't the ultimate driver of in isolation as to whether a business will or won't invest. But there are courses being offered to people to look at where would you like to invest and what are the factors that you might consider, and tax is an element.
I mean, the international evidence is very clearly in line with what you said. It's one of the few places where everyone from McKinsey's to the International Monetary Fund to the Tax Justice Network is in entire agreement that tax just doesn't feature in the location decision. The decision is made, and then maybe companies go lobbying for tax breaks, but they know where they want to be, and it's on the basis of those much more substantive elements. The risk of, you know, Brexit, of course, is it takes us out of the state aid regulation and opens up the UK as a whole, certainly, to lobbying by businesses for tax breaks in a way that before they'd have been batted off as illegal. And that's, you know, one of many risks there.
Can I just mention a comparison with the Irish situation? Because when you're discussing corporation tax, it seems almost obligatory to do so. I declare an interest, I have an Irish passport, not surprising with my name. In that case, we see something which is quite different from what we've just been discussing. Real businesses do not locate on the basis of tax. You will not find many substantial businesses in many of the world's most recognised tax havens. You know, pharmaceuticals are not developed in Cayman or Jersey or the Isle of Man or anywhere else, although vast numbers of patents for those products are in those places. There is a disconnect between the substance and the form in which a lot of the world is taxed. And corporation tax makes that possible. because the legal form of a company lets you separate the substance of the transaction from the legal form in which it is taxed. So there are some countries, and Ireland is a perfect example of this, which have encouraged the location of profits, but without necessarily actually attracting much substance in terms of people. I accept that some people go to Ireland, but not that many in relation to the profits which are apparently recorded there, which is why we ended up with what Paul Krugman called leprechaun economics with regard to Irish GDP, which can be so massively restated depending on whether Apple decides to record its profits in or out of that country, because that has nothing to do with the productivity of Ireland as a whole. So we have to be very careful here to make sure that we're looking at substance. If you're interested in having substantial real economic activity, then incorporation, taxation, and other things make very little difference. You're looking at infrastructure, people, quality of the law, health services, so that people turn up in the morning fit for work, and everything else as the basis for locational decisions. If you're looking at opportunities to provide tax abuse, then go by all means into tax competition, but you're going down a very dangerous path indeed, because a lot of the world's tax havens at present are looking decidedly dodgy with regard to their own finances.
Thank you. Just following up on some of the comments on incorporation as well. I mean, clearly taking a step back, incorporation is a good thing, right? Because it's a signal of people, innovation, entrepreneurship, starting businesses, creating wealth, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So at that level, absolutely. And it's one of the measures we use to see the health of the economy. Are we creating enough startup businesses, et cetera? But clearly we've identified an area where there is that overlap where people are should be employed but are using incorporation as a means to avoid tax. And I welcome the comments by Richard Murphy around about the risk profile, because having been in the same position as you on both sides of that fence, not knowing whether you're going to get paid and not knowing if you're ever going to get a holiday are worth quite a lot, right, in terms of, and there needs to be some recognition of that in the reward side as well as the risk side. So I suppose there I just wanted to probe a bit more on is clearly there are rules round about, and rules that have been tightened all the time round about the IR35 or whatever it happens to be, what side of that fence you're on. So your comments on, is the problem that the rules aren't strict enough in allowing people to move from one side to the other? Because in my experience, they're fairly strict. You need to demonstrate certain things. You've got several customers, you provide your own equipment, et cetera, in order to be treated as a legitimate corporation. So are the rules not strict enough, or are they not being enforced properly? Or where is the issue? Because frankly, some of the examples that you mentioned and I hear about, clearly their employment, and I'm very surprised people are able to incorporate to do some of the things that they do, in my experience of having worked in business.
I don't entirely agree with some of what's been said about tax having no impact at all, other than with extremely abusive cases. I think there are situations, and incorporation is one, where yes, there are lots of other factors that come into play, but obviously it is a kind of quantifiable difference, and it will have an effect. And I think that may be true with some of these things about Ireland as well. So outside the clearly purely abusive area, there's a kind of weighing up. But I think, if you are even in a very kind of mobile business, and you want to calculate the tax quite finely, you face a big problem, which is that there's a lot of countries in the world, and they change their rules and the rates all the time. So actually, it isn't kind of minutely calculated and mechanistic, however sophisticated you try and be. It goes a lot, I suppose, by feel and a sense of the direction things are going in. And I think that's why quite often the countries obsess a bit on the headline rates, because they believe, rightly or wrongly, that's kind of more of a signal, more of a visible signal than some of the more detailed rules. But when it comes to IR35, of course, we've just imposed the UK level in the public sector a much stronger sort of anti-avoidance around tax-motivated, getting people off the payroll and then incorporating them. And, given the sort of demise of the Chancellor's attempt to, level the self-employment playing field the other way, if you got out your crystal ball, you might suspect that anti-avoidance will get rolled out to the larger private companies before long, because what UK government is going to sit there and see you know, an erosion of the tax base without, you know, without doing anything about it. I think, you know, as a sort of institute, we are members of tax advisors, we don't take a kind of political position as to whether there should be a differential between the employed and the self-employed in the tax system. But we do say if you want to have a differential, you ought to have a much more clear, even if it has to be a bit complicated, a kind of decision tree, a clearer set of rules. Because part of the problem at the moment is it's based so much on case law and so dependent on a variety of facts and circumstances that it's very easy for an employer to convince himself that somebody could be classified as self-employed because there are so few hard and fast rules. It's all, you know, there are cases that go different ways. So I think if you wanted to maintain some differential long term, you ought to be a lot clearer about it, and that would help.
Where do you start on this one?
I'll follow.
I would suggest that you actually again need to stand back and look at this question, because what we're dealing with here is a beast which is wholly unsuited to the modern world, the limited company. It wasn't designed for the 21st century. It was designed in the 19th century when you had separation of capital from management, where there were meant to be distinct rules that governed the conduct of directors who were accountable to the shareholders who were not the same people and so on. It was never envisaged that we would have a company which was one person who was simultaneously shareholder, director, sole creator of value in the company. This just was not the beast that was created in the 19th century, and the UK is pretty much responsible for that beast. Creation. What we need is a form of incorporation which is suitable for business in the 21st century. Scotland does have some distinct and separate forms of incorporation. We know the Scottish Limited Partnership, although we probably know it best at the moment for the fact that that is also being abused. But Scotland could look at whether there is a suitable beast that could be created to encourage enterprise, but which is also significantly less open to tax abuse. The obvious way to do that is to create a larger company, which is for those businesses which require a certain degree of capital intensity, and which may therefore still be subject to a corporation tax, but a smaller company which provides the protection of limited liability, the separate entity principle, which allows it to contract in its own right, whilst actually being a see-through entity, as a limited liability partnership is, with regard to taxation, so that the profits are automatically attributed to the members to be taxed by them as income tax, and therefore there is no arbitrage available between the different corporation tax, national insurance, and income tax. Now, we know that LLPs have been abused because they have been extensively used by offshore companies incorporating in the UK to then not pay tax in this country whilst appearing to be a UK entity. This would therefore require some degree of withholding tax to prevent overseas abuse of this structure. But I would suggest to you that Scotland could actually look at whether an innovation is possible to actually come up with a new hybrid style entity which encourages enterprise, which is fully accountable, puts its accounts on public record, but which does provide this degree of tax neutrality that would stop this game playing, which is largely for the benefit of the accountancy profession.
Is that something that would be possible within the devolved settlement?
I'm not entirely sure it's possible at the moment. Okay. I presume that devolved settlements are always available for negotiation. Yeah. I'm sorry, I think everything in life is up for negotiation.
If only it was that simple. Charlotte.
If we're coming back to the devolved tax powers, then we're looking at income tax. And I think, coming back to my earlier point, we can overemphasise this point about people incorporating, because as you rightly say, it's not that easy just to step out of employment and become self-employed or become a company. So that one needs to be kept in perspective. And we also need to keep in perspective too that a lot of our higher paid people are in public sector as well. So again, they're the least likely to be able to do this kind of tax planning, if that's the word for it. So we have to be careful around there. I think, too, we need to be mindful that companies don't automatically equal good or bad. You know, there are other forms. OTS, the Office of Tax Simplification, said about 10% of businesses are partnerships. And we should, I think they're a really sound form of business, and maybe there should be a stronger emphasis on some of those and self-employment. And then last but not least, just in terms of the conversation we've just been having, I think companies do, there are some people, some of our members, not all of our members, but some of our members question the lowering of corporation tax rates. But on the other hand, most of our members do emphasise that companies actually do contribute a lot in other taxes, whether it's employment taxes or collecting VAT, national insurance, and we shouldn't forget that end of it either if we want to encourage businesses to set up here.
OK, and we've covered a lot of that area now in terms of the discussion we've had, and so I think there's some stuff around the gig economy that Adam wanted to explore with you.
Thank you, Kavina. I wanted to take you to the relationship between tax, the powers that we have in this Parliament, and a number of things, Mr. Murphy, that you've been talking about do not fall within the competence of this Parliament, but the relationship between tax, the powers of this Parliament, and the nature of the employment market. In Scotland, and we all hear a lot as politicians and as policymakers about the changing nature of the employment market, the rise of the gig economy. The first opportunity here is for one of you to put your finger on that label, gig economy, and define it, because I'm not sure that it's used in a consistent or even coherent way. And picking up on a number of things that Charlotte has said over the course of the morning, it's still the case, I think, in the UK generally and in Scotland specifically, that 85% thereabouts of workers are employees. So the question really is that the right balance for the economy? If not, should we be seeking to increase that percentage or decrease that percentage? And what can we do within our competence, if we should seek to change it, to try and encourage or facilitate those changes? Should we be making it easier for people to move from employment status to self-employed status, or should we be making it more difficult? It seems to me that the picture that the panel is painting is not entirely clear on that. So really a question around what the relationship is between the tax powers that we have and the nature of the employment market in Scotland at the moment. Perhaps to start with Charlotte.
If I start on that one, I think from the perspective of ICAS, we wouldn't necessarily comment on whether one should be pushing towards more employment or self-employment. Our kind of remit is primarily to look at the kind of operational aspects of how taxes work. So I perhaps ought to say that for starters. In terms of a gig economy, I quite like the way the OTS have tried to analyse that in the Institute of Fiscal Studies, in that I think one of the difficulties all around the sector is that there are rights for employees and employment law, and then the tax law versus around employment and self-employment is different, and it's how all those bits kind of fall in the middle. So gig economy, to my way of thinking, you've got employees on the one hand, you've got completely self-employed on the other hand, and you've got folk that kind of fall somewhere in the middle, where they're kind of quasi-employees, like the Uber case taxi drivers, and it's quite difficult to really shunt them one way or the other, and the Taylor report's looking at that, and it'll be interesting to see what comes of it, and hopefully that might help set the direction travel for teasing those things out. And I think in terms of tax powers, because they're income tax powers only, you're looking primarily at employees, and it's a question for you as to whether you want to use those tax powers to try and retain employment, because that's the easiest way to pick up the income tax from it, under PAYE, for instance, and from 85% of the population, or whether tax is just one element and hopefully it'll pan out.
Thank you.
I'm not entirely sure that all the things I said are not within the scope of this Parliament. Remember, you're responsible for income tax, and what I'm actually suggesting in ways in which you can identify those who might pay income tax. And Revenue Scotland clearly has a relationship with the Scottish Government and a responsibility to it to collect the tax that is owing under income tax rules in Scotland. So there is a... I'm corrected on that.
HMRC collects income tax. Revenue Scotland is responsible for taxes which are devolved in full.
I'm sorry, in full, yes. So, but there is still a dialogue to be had about the taxes that are collected on behalf of the Scottish Government, where it has got the right to make decisions over the taxes that are due. And a lot of taxation, in my experience, is based upon soft negotiation, not hard legislation. And I think all four of us sitting at this end of the table will be used to having regular meetings, which would be described as soft discussions about how the tax system should work, but which don't actually result in legislation or anything else. So I think that in this area of the gig economy, you have the power to actually make representations on how you want things to be managed to ensure that income tax is paid. And I think you should be encouraging people to adopt the right form, and Scotland should try to make sure that self-employment, where it is the right thing for somebody, is something that they can pursue, whether as a self-employed person, as a partnership or as a company, or whether there's other forms of company that might in due course be allowed. But you should also be encouraging HMRC to make sure it collects income tax where it's due on behalf of the Scottish Government, because that seems to me to be incredibly important. If that's a lever which you're using as part of Scottish policy, then to make sure that HMRC is using its powers for that purpose seems to me to be a fundamental part of the duty. And it doesn't require devolved powers, it requires discussion and pressure to be brought to bear.
I was just going to say, I would definitely second the fact that, because I think it's a UK issue, this kind of gig economy and how all the different taxes kind of converge, I think in terms of policy here, it would be helpful to continue Scottish Government officials and Revenue Scotland and everybody else working as closely as possible with HMRC. But I think they probably do that anyway.
Yeah. Alex, do you want to come in on this?
There's a point on incorporation and a point on tax. On incorporation, I think, you know, Ivan raised earlier this, and Richard, the origins of incorporation in terms of spurring entrepreneurship by providing limited liability. The quid pro quo for that was always the publishing of accounts to guarantee that those people whose liability was being allowed to be limited, who were getting that benefit, were also accountable to other people operating the market, to suppliers, to customers, and so on. And that transparency of their accounts was what provided some guarantee of that. In some ways, you know, so that goes to one point. There's a risk that because we allow through bad enforcement, but also through other forms of incorporation, we allow that quid pro quo to fade away, and that undermines the efficiency of the market because you have some actors within the market who don't face the same accountability as others. But the gig economy takes us to the other side. And in this way, you know, I very much agree with Richard that the corporate entity, as we think of it, isn't really structured for this type of economy. Instead of thinking about how people might be using companies to avoid their accountabilities of one sort or another, we also need to be thinking about how companies are used to impose a worse settlement on the people doing the work through that company. And that's a very different type of accountability problem from the one that was originally considered in the limited liability creation. And you know, obviously a lot of this goes well beyond what this Parliament is able to take action about, but I think it's worth having in mind. The tax side of that is just to say, you know, there's abundant evidence that paying tax is a social act, not an economically rational one. People in every jurisdiction and in every type of tax you can look at pay more tax than they should do if we think that how people decide how much tax to pay is on the basis of whether they'll get caught and how much they'll have to pay if they get caught. People consistently pay well beyond that because they're taking part in tax as a social act. Now, what that means, among other things, is that there is a power with the Parliament well beyond the devolution settlement in terms of the type of positions that you express about the social acceptability of particular tax behaviour. And in particular, you might want to consider the kind of positions that you're stressing about the appropriate use or otherwise of incorporation in different ways. And you might expect, at least to an extent, for that to have an impact beyond any legal power that you may actually have to back that, because you provide an expression of social acceptability when you make that kind of statement, and that does influence behaviour.
I think if, getting back to the thing about the gig economy, if more people in society, you know, want to be their own boss, happy to take the risks that, you know, Richard mentioned, and either because they think they can make more money building up a business, or indeed because of a lifestyle choice that they can take time off when they want, and so on. If people want to do all that genuinely, you know, it's not the job of the tax system to say that's a bad thing. It's the job of the tax system to accommodate it. But I think where the tax issue comes in is partly if, as a matter of fact, doing things that way is more lightly taxed, rightly or wrongly, than employment, then the policymakers have got to say, well, somehow or other the money's got to be made up, and we would suggest some kind of public debate around that would be is the best way forward. And the other point is when there's not really such a dramatic change in the underlying lifestyle, but where people are being shoehorned, maybe with pressure from the employer, into the form, you know, that sort of structure, where, you know, arguably it does become more abusive, and it's kind of very unlikely that the policymakers are going to want to sit there and say, we just accept that less tax is being, you know, paid as a result. So I think it's, I think the tax system has to react, as it were, to the kind of to the social pressures a little bit.
Very helpful. Thank you very much.
We've had a wide-ranging discussion now. I want to try to, if Willie, I think you want to get into the area of actually, at the end of the day, what does this all mean for the Scottish Bloc and for through the fiscal framework, and what that actually means for the amount of money that in Scotland we've got to spend. So if we tease some of that out, then I'll come back to others to cover the other wider areas I want to talk about. We really need to get some of that on the record.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Both Richard and John mentioned the imbalance in terms of the powers that Scotland does and doesn't have. You talked about powers on one side of the equation and not the other, John. And Richard, you were talking about being exposed to a small part of the system about which we can do very little, and we should go back to the negotiating table. But I wanted to ask you, what's your view of the fiscal framework in that regard? Does it provide any counterbalance for Scotland where adjustments may need to be carried out? Is it strong enough, or do we genuinely, in your view, need to go back and renegotiate this arrangement?
Can I just add a bit into that as well, in terms of that whole wide question? Because it strikes me that if we have the difference in the number of incorporations, self-employed, etc., between Scotland and the UK, what impact will that potentially have on the block grant? In your view, if you've looked at that issue, it would be useful for us to hear, because at the end of the day, it might mean we have less or more money to spend than we expected if there are more incorporations proceeding in the rest of the UK compared with Scotland, for instance. So when you're dealing with Willie's question, if you could pick that up as well, I think that would be useful.
Asking about the kind of no detriment element.
Yes.
I think one of the things, and maybe Richard, you might want to pick this up, is when it comes to accountability and the transparency of the fiscal framework and being able to see what goes in and how it gets mooshed around and comes back out as no detriment, or equally, I think it's quite difficult to quantify how much stems directly from Scottish policy and how much stems directly from UK policy, and I think unpicking that actually will prove quite difficult.
But do you see any mechanisms in the framework that will attempt to deal with that kind of scenario?
I haven't investigated the actual machinations of the calculations. No, sorry.
I mean, our members are, you know, are tax advisors dealing with tax issues at the nitty-gritty level day to day. So that's where a kind of our expertise as an institute, you know, comes out. We're not, you know, constitutional experts, to be quite frank. And I would sort of tend to think, you know, no system is ever going to be perfect. I mean, if you had sort of full and complete tax powers over the whole tax system, you would still have to react to kind of decisions that neighbouring countries and jurisdictions made, because, you know, behavioural effects go across borders, and, you know, and equally, if nothing was devolved, that probably wouldn't be perfect, you know, either. There'd be no responsiveness to local, you know, Scottish concerns. So nothing is going to be perfect. But I think my impression is there's been an attempt made with a new, you know, relatively new powers here to kind of have more of a debate of this nature about, you know, what the way forward is. And I think part of the problem is this historic, you know, lack of consultation and the springing of surprises at UK level. Because after all, until recently, at the UK level, there has been complete powers more or less over the, you know, virtually all the tax system. The EU limitations are really quite limited. And yet we've allowed these big imbalances to grow up. And I think partly that's because the system's got ever more complicated. This tradition of surprises being sprung on budget day. So the decisions are all made by a very limited number of people who may be very expert, but they clearly don't see all the ramifications because of the secrecy and the hurried nature of those deliberations. So, you know, we've even allowed these imbalances to grow up with a system where there is complete control over more or less everything. So I think, you know, more debate at the various different levels, has got to be encouraged, and more attempt to have a more consistent, sense of directions rather than being kind of so reactive.
But if you wanted to do that, I think you'd need to start by having a much broader kind of public information programme, because certainly I speak to people about Scottish taxes, and like Richard, the joy of tax, I find it all very exciting, but I'm in a minority. And most people think Scottish taxes, on you go, Charlotte. And actually, we've got a really interesting set of different powers that have been devolved, whether, it's partly through income tax, which gives you a kind of, it's a version of the block grant in many respects, and you'll not change it radically. And then we've got the properly devolved taxes like LBTT and this landfill tax, and there's quite a lot you can do with that, and there's the capacity to make new taxes, and there could be some imaginative thinking around there. And I think if one was to start taking that out and about and explaining it to people and the different elements of it, then we would take our debates a lot further, and it would help to filter through the fiscal framework so that people could then say, well, what's that about and how does it work and where does this no detriment sit? And the no detriment in itself is interesting, because if you took it to the nth degree, you wouldn't devolve the powers, would you?
No.
The same, yeah. I mean, there was quite a surprise sprung. There was a surprise, quite a substantial surprise sprung yesterday as well, in that regard that you've talked about. But Richard, why do we need to then go back to the negotiating table in this matter if there is such an imbalance in the powers that we have?
Well, there are extraordinary imbalances in the relationship, and I mean, a few weeks ago, for better or worse, I wrote a blog about GERS, Government Expenditure and Revenue Scotland statement, for which my Twitter timeline is still suffering. I can assure you that I have never met anywhere which is more interested in national income accounting than Scotland. You have turned it into a national obsession, it seems. I was a little surprised by the reaction. So I walk with a little trepidation, knowing full well that someone somewhere will have a lot to say about what follows. But the simple fact is that the amount that is known about Scottish taxation is very little indeed. Yeah, let's put it bluntly. Inside GERS, 25 of the 26 income figures are estimates. And as Graham Roy has said, Fraser of Allender Institute, and he was responsible preparing it for 7 years, they are prepared on the basis that Scotland is a mini part of the UK and the figures are simply an apportionment of the UK as a whole. So, in other words, Scotland is not an independent entity, and yet I'm sitting in what seems to me to be the Scottish Parliament, which clearly recognises that Scotland has some independence as an entity, and is being given devolved taxation powers, but is not being given the data to make decisions upon. That was the core argument that I presented. And however you look at GERS, and yes, I am quite sure that those who are tasked with preparing it do it with all good faith and with due diligence on the data they get from the ONS and elsewhere. But nobody would ever prepare the income statement for a region, a devolved country administration or whatever else on the basis of samples and statistics if you could actually collect the population data. You know, as in statistical terms, you'd always like to know the real figure, not the statistical estimate of what that might be. And if the GERS statement was so good as a basis for estimating Scottish taxation income, then the UK would use that system as a whole, but I assure you it doesn't. It actually uses the data on the amount of tax collected. Which is obvious direction of travel. So if Scotland is going to get a fair deal on tax under whatever system exists, however it's framed, whatever the rules on detriment and so on, then Scotland needs the data to make decisions to see how these issues do impact upon it. And it's no good just having information on income tax, which is obviously and income tax from employment, which is obviously the one area where there now looks to be a reasonable chance of the quality of data improving, because as we're seeing, what's going on here is an arbitrage between one tax and another tax, taxes that will be subject to Scottish rates, taxes that we will not be, national insurance, corporation tax, and so on. And there, who knows, whether or not you have Scottish registered businesses or not does, of course, even potentially have impact upon the VAT collected in Scotland as well. And it could quite easily have that as well. Because if there isn't business in Scotland, there'll be less VAT charged as such on a differentiated business framework in Scotland. And that does have an impact. So one of the things that you need to do if you're going to get this framework right is to actually say, for heaven's sake, can we please have the real information? And I wouldn't make this request just for Scotland. I think Wales needs it, Northern Ireland needs it. I can see good reason why you should be cooperating with colleagues in other parliaments and assemblies for that reason. Indeed, I can't actually see why the new mayor of Manchester won't want this if he's going to ask for taxing powers. It is going to be a he. I'm not being gender specific here. Why London may not want it and so on, because the data should be collected. But Scotland very definitely needs it because you have taxing powers. And at the moment, you simply do not have the right information. I tell my students when I teach them about the quality of data that they're going to interpret to actually look at whether it's good information or not. And the phrase I use is crap. Crap is a technical term. It stands for completely rubbish approximations. And that's what you get to assess your tax system at present.
Thank you.
Anybody else want to reflect?
I might just add on that a broader point, not that I want to join in the fun of Richard's Twitter timeline. but, you know, internationally, it's very clear that control of data is associated with the strength of fiscal decentralisation. You know, and at the extreme, you have something like Sudan, where, you know, I was apparently persona non grata for a while for doing research using their regional state data because it demonstrated a deliberate decision to exacerbate inequalities, but the data had been kept hidden nationally until we took it from the IMF and then republished it into Sudan. That's not to say that Scotland's in that position, but it's worth saying, you know, you have that relationship does broadly exist, and in terms of the willingness of people to pay tax, the two things it rests upon fairly consistently from evidence of both experimental and actual, are the sense that other people are paying their taxes and the sense that taxes that are paid are being redistributed effectively. If people don't have confidence in the data about where money is coming from into Scotland or about where it is then being spent, how inequalities here might compare with those in the rest of the UK, or that entirety of that process, what you're doing over time is eroding rather than strengthening the relationship between state and citizen, and therefore the likelihood of paying tax as a social act. So this isn't just an argument that takes place on Twitter about some technical accounting issues, right? You know, that data question is fundamental to the politics and the social engagement.
Okay. Patrick.
Where to begin? Joining the conversation after this long, there's been an incredible breadth. Let's just say, you know, my view is that the strongest evidence that we've had so far from this panel is that we are a very long way from having either a taxation system or a company law system that meets the needs that I think most of us would subscribe to of sharing the wealth of the economy properly, as well as ensuring the adequate revenues for public services. We're not going to fix that in this committee meeting. We're not going to fix that unilaterally at the moment. Maybe that one day this Parliament will be in a position to make many more decisions about this. It may be that one day we'll be in a position to have a negotiation with the UK government without being told that now is not the time to resolve some of those questions. Where we are right now, I'm keen that we focus on some specific actions that this Parliament may be able to recommend in relation to some of the problems. Let's assume that there is a broad policy agreement from the Scottish Government, and we may have to ask them this and test this, that they agree that the phenomenon of people incorporating specifically to move what most people would regard as their income out of income tax and into corporation tax. Let's assume the Scottish Government believes that that is a bad thing and it should be tackled and reduced. Does any of you have any information about the scope of the Scottish devolved public sector, the Scottish government, local government, health boards, public agencies that the Scottish government is responsible for, either their direct employment arrangements or the contractors that they work with, the private sector organisations they have relationships with, procurement? What is the scope for using the power of the current devolved government to limit or eradicate these practices at present, or indeed, as Alex Cobham, I think, was talking about, stigmatising them further, creating additional disincentives to this behaviour? Are there any specific actions you can recommend that we could take right now?
That's an interesting approach, and I think tax should be part of your wider policies, and it's just one element of it. And you're absolutely right, there are other elements that sit with it. And if we're coming back to the powers that you have here and now, and you're looking at a Scottish approach to taxation, then I think you can usefully build a bigger picture and have a very positive approach to taxation by setting out broad principles that you might want to follow over the course of the Parliament, a roadmap, call it what you will, as to how you would like things to go about. I completely agree with you, Alec. There can be far wider messages about whether you do or don't want tax avoidance. I mean, that came through quite strongly, didn't it, when you were doing the Revenue Scotland Tax Powers Act, as to having a general anti-avoidance rule rather than an abuse rule and making it slightly broader. And I think all that kind of messaging can help sit round about this.
Kind of sounds a bit wet, but I do sort of think that public debate and indicating senses of direction are quite important, because certainly when we surveyed our members to go into the input to the original evidence we gave, there was quite a strong emphasis on stability and simplicity if possible, and and sense of direction, because I think In the kind of UK tradition, which Scotland in a way is part of and has inherited, you tend to get these kind of suddenly announced changes, and each one tends to make for a more complicated system. And people don't know whether, if it's an adjustment on employment or self-employment, that's the end of the agenda, or whether it's a signal for new things. So if at least the government tried to give some broad indications of, where it was trying to take the devolved powers over time and, as and when resources permitted, so there's a clearer sense of direction, it enables people to, understand where they are a little bit. And I think that does affect behaviours as well. If people, for example, get the sense that that over time the policy will be to try and get a more level playing field between incorporation and non-incorporation, if that, was to be your policy, I think you would find, even with nothing else changing, there would be less tax-motivated incorporations, because people would be less inclined to go through a lot of hoops for something that maybe had a more limited shelf life.
Well, that's a useful phrase, go through a lot of hoops. Can we put more hoops in place? Can we make this a more difficult process to go through, or one where we put more disincentives in the way of that behaviour?
Well, I think one of the issues is that although you have power over the Scottish rates of income tax, those don't extend to some of the detailed rules. So that, that again, I think is quite difficult. But I think adopting a more consultative, debating sort of approach would have a knock-on effect at the UK level, because there is just a growing body of opinion that this tradition of secrecy and surprise, has just gone too far and is not serving any purpose. So I think even where, you would need cooperation or some kind of cooperation or change or whatever at the UK level to give a sense of what direction you would try to take things, I think would be, very helpful, to you and probably the rest of the UK.
I think there are a number of areas where some quite specific actions can be taken. First of all, and I haven't read the rules for a couple of years, I confess this, but Scotland has quite different rules on procurement from the rest of the UK. And the way in which taxation was built into those rules on government procurement were different from the rest of the UK, as I recall it. They were more specific. That tax was to be considered a factor in procurement more specifically than has been done for UK local authorities, for example. And that is a route where some action could be taken. The current indication is that people are only willing to discriminate in procurement when there is clear sign of abuse. That might be, for example, a referral to under the GAR, whether UK as a whole or Scottish, or some form of sanction has been imposed. Now, those are very, very high level hurdles to jump over because, frankly, nobody's ever been referred under the UK GAR rules. So, you know, frankly, that's a meaningless test at the moment. It's existed since 2013 and never been used. So that cannot be the criteria. So you could, however, think about other criteria. We now know, as from literally the 5th of, or 6th of April, we have these new IR35 rules, which are going to apply to public sector bodies, hiring people who are on disguised employment contracts. You could say nobody from the private sector can be employed to substitute for a public sector service if they are using arrangements which would not be acceptable in the public sector for taxation purposes. So obtaining an unfair competitive advantage as a result, purely by exploiting the tax system. That is an entirely possible thing for Scotland to do and look at, and it's within your powers. That could be in the public procurement process. I'd also talk about something, again, slightly softer, but the largest company to have a fair tax mark, and I will disclose I'm a director of the fair tax mark, is a Scottish company. It's SSE, which has been a pioneer in talking about tax responsibility and has done a good job on that particular task in promoting publicity around its tax affairs. The Scottish Government could look at how it could encourage other companies to follow their example, to improve the quality of their disclosure, to disclose what they're paying, how, when, where and why, and to therefore actually show that they're paying their tax in Scotland.
For that, and I might ask Alex Cobham to respond because he was talking about these the social values attached to tax as well. One option for that would be the Scottish Government's business pledge, which is intended to promote ethical behaviour around living wage and other factors, not exploiting younger workers and so on, promoting gender diversity. There's a range of things. There are clearly areas where that kind of pledge could go further and could become a precondition to accessing state-funded forms of business support services. Could we add in a tax ethics aspect of that kind of measure?
That makes a lot of sense, but I would, you know, we've talked about debate, we've talked about changing rules, and at the risk of coming over all Tony Blair, you know, there's a third way here, which is, you know, through the middle of this, pledges and debates take you so far. Rule changes are harder to achieve. In the middle is the data. And, you know, I was sitting here thinking, what a good question you'd asked. And then I realised, actually, that's a slightly shocking question. It's a good question for me to ask. And I'm thinking, well, you know, you could go to all the public bodies and with freedom of information, you could start putting together this information. But from your side of the table?
Already, yeah.
Right, exactly. So, you know, having data in the public domain for every Scottish public body on the proportion, let's say, of their spending which goes through certain types of structures, the proportion of their procurement spending which goes to companies with the fair tax mark, that kind of information allowing, whether you do it yourselves or you allow civil society, to put together the rankings that are going to start putting pressure on those who are at the extremes. Seems like it, you know, it doesn't have the difficulties of making hard rules, but it is much more likely than discussion alone to drive behavioural change. And if that information actually isn't available to you now, it really should be, and then to everyone else.
I think that's very helpful. Thank you.
Anybody got any supplementaries on that? Because I was going to, if not, I was going to go to Ash, because I think she had some wider questions as well. Ash.
Thank you. It's been a very interesting discussion this morning, so thanks to the panel for that. But my particular question is with regard to Richard Murphy's evidence that you put in the principles of Scottish taxation. So in that, you suggested that Scottish principles might be, and your word for that was insufficient. So I appreciate your thoughts on that. But also, you spoke about Scotland's current tax powers, which you described as being largely symbolic and potentially also booby-trapped. So I was wondering if you could explain a little bit about what you mean by that.
I have a feeling my Twitter timeline is about to explode again. That's all right. That's life. I was concerned about this suggestion that we go back to 1776 and we use Adam Smith as the basis of the principles for Scottish taxation. You know, he was a good Scottish moral philosopher. He wouldn't have recognised the term economist at the time. But he didn't know most of the taxes we're now talking about. You know, the tax system at the time was fundamentally different, and Adam Smith's understanding of tax is, I would suggest, out of date. Now, I argue for something called modern taxation theory, which argues that taxation has, and Alex is, I think it's fair to say, broadly in the same space, that taxation has a very large social and macroeconomic role, as well as being a purely technical function of revenue raising. I actually argue it doesn't even raise revenue, but that's a secondary issue we'll leave aside, I think, at the moment. And therefore, the tax system has to be reflective of its true social function, which again, Alex and I have been saying regularly here. I'm not in any way arguing with the colleagues from professional institutes who are looking at the technical aspects, but tax is much, much bigger than that. You know, of the reasons for tax, redistribution, repricing market failure, these are really, really important. Raising representation in a democracy. People who pay income tax actually vote. If you're interested in engaging people in the political process, actually taking people out of tax is not the right way to go. Rather bizarrely, but nevertheless certainly true. Now, for that reason, I suggested that these four proposed bases are not sufficient for Scotland. Tax is a part of the management of an economy, and therefore you have to put it fairly and squarely into macroeconomic policy as well. And most of the considerations of efficiency, certainty, which is a very deeply ambiguous word, as Alex has explored in his submission, and so on, are too micro-focused. So you have to bring it up to talking about what is the government trying to achieve? What is its social and economic policy, and how can tax help implement that? The whole thesis of my book, The Joy of Tax, is that tax has the greatest... It is the tool that has the greatest power to change the shape of society available to a government. And therefore, the principles should do that. The system should therefore reflect the priorities of the Scottish people, was my next suggestion, rather than anything technical. And it should encourage the engagement of people in the democratic process, which is why I was talking about, and Alex is talking about in this sense, data and the availability of data to encourage people to understand the process of government of which they are a part and which they need to be encouraged to take their part. And so I felt those were really important before we came down to the more mundane things like, you know, talking about minimising opportunities for abuse and so on. So I didn't feel as though, and I read much of the evidence that was submitted to you in the autumn of last year, and I felt that a lot of it entirely missed those points, and that the evidence provided was not about the foundations of Scottish taxation, was not about principles, but was about administrative tools and how they can be structured, but that's some way operationally after the strategic goals and foundation principles for the tax system. So I think that, to me, was quite critical. Having done that, I've completely forgotten what the second part of your question was, and I'm terribly sorry, Ash, for saying that.
It was about the largely symbolic nature of the, you know, income tax that's been devolved, yeah.
When you devolve a very small number of tools, you have to look at the decision that has been made by the person devolving them as to whether they are setting up the person who's been given a responsibility is designed to succeed or fail. And I would say this if I was looking at a business. You know, I have seen managers in businesses who've devolved responsibility to members of staff who can only fail as a result of making any decision that has been given to them. They have been booby-trapped. Has Scotland been booby-trapped by being given a very limited range of powers? And my answer is yes. I mean, if you're trying to create a fair tax system, you can't do that by changing the tax system for income from earnings alone. We only have to look at incorporation to realise that. How daft is it that a person who has incorporated their business in Scotland can decide for themselves whether they are within the Scottish or the UK income tax system by deciding whether to pay themselves by way of salary or by way of dividend? One is within the Scottish rate system and one is without. That is a booby trap. because it immediately might encourage some, and there's some evidence of this, by the way, in academic research, that some people who don't like the Scottish devolved situation will choose to incorporate and pay dividends simply to deny a source of income. That is clear that this happens in the States, by the way. The tax gap increases in states which are the opposite from the federal government in power. So if it's a Republican state, it will have a higher non-compliance rate when it's a Democratic president, and maybe vice versa. I say maybe because more Democrats tend to pay employment taxes than be self-employed. But certainly there's clear evidence of a political process, even in tax payment. And so this decision to simply give this tiny range of powers to Scotland leaves it with a very limited range of choices where the changes are, I mean, I'm not saying £400 a year is symbolic, because it's not symbolic, £400 a year is real, but in relative terms to the overall tax liability of those paying it, it is a relatively small part, but does create the potential for a significant backlash and political furore where, frankly, very little is really due. And I felt that that was, therefore, the provision of powers which were tinkering at the edges of the system when what were required were the right to actually ask deep fundamental questions of how Scotland really wants to create, as I've reflected, a tax system that really reflects the social priorities of Scotland, which I do not perceive to be the same as those of the UK necessarily as a whole. I mean, I think that's probably true. I only have to be here. I'm here quite often. I realise that this is different. Scotland is not the same as London, for example. So in that sense, the powers granted did not let you achieve the result, and that's why I called them booby-trapped.
Can I ask a follow-up to that?
Does anybody else want to reflect on the first set of questions first before I ask the follow-up?
No, thanks.
Right. Ash, on you go.
I was just going to say, you want to say that you know, you feel that Scotland should have a much broader range of taxes devolved, but then you also mention Scotland should be benefiting from QE issuance. I wonder if you could just explain that.
Well, one of the problems that you have is that, of course, you are required by the rules that exist to effectively create a balanced budget. This is a constraint that does not exist for the UK government. First of all, it can borrow, but secondly, we now know that it doesn't have to borrow because it can cancel its own debt. It's not widely recognised that QE cancels debt, but it does. And the evidence is very clearly available. Just go and look at the whole of government accounts for the UK government, and you will discover that, in fact, UK government debt is not at the present point of time some 1.7 trillion or so, as is regularly rolled out in news bulletins. It's £435 billion less than that, because the debt has been cancelled by QE. And so, for example, in the last year, whilst it is expected that the final figure for borrowing by the UK government will be £51 billion, in fact, £60 billion of debt will have been cancelled under QE, and therefore, actually, overall UK government indebtedness last year fell, even though there was a deficit. Now, Scotland is not in that position because none of that QE capacity is devolved to Scotland. But the benefit could be considerable. Now, I'm well aware that Jeremy Corbyn once borrowed this idea but didn't use it for very long, and he called it people's QE. I didn't write it for him. I make that clear. He borrowed it, and I was quite happy for him to borrow it. But the idea was to use QE as a proactive measure to provide an investment fund to ensure that there could be a long-term infrastructure programme to develop the economy of the UK and Scotland and others. I do not see why Scotland could not go to the UK and say, hey, hang on a minute, £435 billion, even if we just apply that on the basis of headcount. That's a mighty lot of money which could have been given to Scotland to provide a fund for investment in this country which we've not had available to us. Now, that is a soft discussion. It's not within devolved powers. It's not being discussed by anybody else either. But it's the sort of issue that I believe needs to be on the table because this is part of the whole macroeconomic debate. Tax does not even exist in isolation within macroeconomy. Taxation, money issuing, QE are all fundamentally related subjects, completely and utterly incapable of being considered in isolation. And so if you're considering tax, you have to consider the right to cancel debt, which is a substitute for tax in terms of the means of payment, and therefore Scotland has to demand that QE be on the agenda, and the right to have the benefit from QE has to be devolved to this Parliament, I suggest.
Thank you.
Okay, has anybody else got any final supplementaries before we wind this session up? Liam? Yep.
Not so much a supplementary, convener, but just some questions around. I'm slightly concerned. There's an awful lot based on perception.
And there seems to be an underlying perception in some of the papers and indeed some of what we've heard today, that people incorporate for reasons to do with tax planning, tax avoidance. And some of the terms that have been used around that, abuse, social acceptability, a bad thing, tax ethics, betrays an underlying perception. Is there any data, or is there any breakdown or analysis that's been done of how many of the limited company contractors are incorporating for tax planning reasons, as against those who are incorporating because it's the best way to sell their skill set, for example? How many are doing it as avoidance, and how many are doing it because it's the right way to model their skill set, their business?
There are quite a lot of studies on this. The Office of Tax Simplification has studied it quite a lot, and the Office of Budgetary Responsibility have looked historically at the problem and the erosion of the tax base and the likelihood of it continuing. I think though it's very difficult, even theoretically, to kind of draw the line between what's tax motivated and what's not, because in the typical case, there's going to be a mixture of motives and considerations, I would suggest. So even if you could actually get inside people's hearts and sort of, you know, measure exactly what they were thinking, you'd probably find it was a bit of a mixture. So I'm not sure how easy it's ever going to be to take it that step further and answer that specific question.
Judith Friedman's done a lot of analysis on this from the Oxford Business School, and yes, I agree, there's a lot of sources on it. The House of Commons Treasury Committee is running an inquiry with elements of this in it just now as well. So it's obviously an issue that a lot of people are thinking of, and that's why I think part of the solution here is by working on a UK basis, because it is a UK issue, and I don't think you can pick out and say somebody incorporated purely for tax purposes. I mean, as accountants, if we were advising folk, you have a checklist that covers kind of limited liability. Lots of people would prefer to be a managing director than just Charlotte Barbour. And on it goes, and there's a raft of factors that are weighed up. Tax is an important element because it's got a specific cost. But of course, on the other side as well, there's a whole raft of reasons for not incorporating, like having to do separate accounts. And once your money goes into a company, you've got the kind of difficulties getting back out because it is a separate legal entity. There's quite a lot of factors in it.
I accept that, and I'm grateful for the answer, because isn't that the fundamental data that is required? Before you say, this is the number of people incorporating is a bad thing, and we must change it. We must do, the government must do something to remodel how the outcome presents itself. Surely the data should be established that says what proportion of people incorporate for tax reasons, to avoid tax, to pay less tax, and what proportion actually are doing it for, if I go back to Ivan McKee's point, for good economic reasons that actually drive a particular economy.
Well, I think the studies that are being undertaken attempt to try and tease that out, because when we went back to our earlier discussions as to there's two elements to this, one being people who maybe are pushed out of employment because of the NIC costs. Now, in those instances where they're forced into incorporation in personal service companies, IR35 kind of companies, I think one generally accepts that in broad terms, it's maybe not a good thing, because it's often largely tax-driven. It might also kind of negate some of the benefits that you would have as an employee, and people tend to look at that as a bad thing. But if you look at the other kind of incorporations, which are people who run, can I call it a proper self business? Do you know what I mean? Making widgets and employing people and having a factory or a kind of office and all that kind of stuff. Those kind of people, the decision will never be purely tax. Is much wider, and incorporating might be a good thing at a certain size or not. Again, one of the things that I think is quite interesting is in the Office of Tax Simplification study on partnership, I think people forget what a lot of strengths there are in other types of vehicle, and there has been a drive towards incorporation, but you get it from the government too. I mean, Gordon Brown, when he instituted a zero rate of corporation tax, sends out a certain signal. There's some reliefs that you only get if you incorporate, and they send out signals too. So it's quite a complex picture.
I think
That's right. It is, if I may, convener, because it is nuanced, and yeah. A number of you have made the point about people being pushed out to incorporate people who would otherwise be employees being pushed out and being forced to incorporate because an employer decides that they want to strip out overhead, for example. But again, is there any data that suggests how many of those people, those otherwise employees, have been forced to incorporate by the employers? Because I'm not persuaded it's there.
No, I don't think. I don't think it is there. In fact, I know it's not there. You cannot be sure of this, although there is quite an easy way to collect it, and I have proposed it several times. I'm not quite sure why, frankly, we're not willing to make the change to collect it. It's very simple. On a corporation tax return, and indeed actually on a self-employed person's tax return, you ask for the taxpayer to disclose their turnover by their top 10 clients, customers, or whatever. If you discover that 99% of their turnover is going to one customer, it is highly likely that's a disguised employment. It's very obvious in that case. If you discover that, in fact, it's going 99% for 4 months to one, and then it's going 99% for the next 4 months to another, that's a series of disguised employments, but they're still disguised employments. This data could be easily found with just a little bit of political willing to change the corporation tax return. And we would then know precisely which companies should be targeted by the revenue to deal with this issue. In other words, they could improve the rate of tax compliance enormously by one simple change to the tax return. But it's not being done, so we don't have the data. The consequence is also that some people who are genuinely self-employed, taking the risks, running a diversified business, are being stigmatized with tax rules which, frankly, are unfair to them. And that is also a consequence we must take into account, because there are people who will be selling their skills through a limited liability entity who have a range of customers, but who will nonetheless now potentially be at risk of being penalised, for example, when contracting with the public sector as a consequence. So we do need to make that change to collect data. It comes back to that same point that Alex and I have been making: data, data, data. And it's not hard to get. We just have to ask the right questions. They're fairly simple. And actually, the questions, if they are simple, in themselves signal the behavioural change we want. We don't want people to incorporate to disguise an employment. If we ask the question that indicates you will be found out if you do this, you discourage the behaviour in the first place. And there is a lot of evidence, again, mainly from the states, that if you ask for the right information, then by and large you get the behavioural consequence you want. Not entirely, because no tax system is perfect, but it's a long way.
Alex and John also wanted to come in there.
I can see why you'd want to get to that specific division, good incorporation, bad incorporation, but I don't think the world is actually like that. And, you know, as Richard's kind of giving some good ideas for how you'd go further down that road, but actually from a policy perspective, you're probably more concerned with the aggregate impact. We don't ban private property because there are burglars, as it were. There is always some abuse in respect of any particular regulation you might have, and that on its own isn't a reason to prevent the possibility, but it goes to the balance. The risk you have here, you know, there's two things. One is it undermines the point Ivan made earlier that you can, you know, if all incorporation is good, then incorporation is a good measure of the economic vitality of your society. But the more that you're seeing incorporation for bad reasons, the weaker that relationship becomes and the less you're confident in that particular measure of growth and the wider benefits of incorporation. In terms of the best impact numbers that there are, you know, these are clearly the ones in terms of the tax base erosion from the Office of Budget Responsibility. As we see consecutive years of multi-billion pound undershoots projected in different forms of tax, particularly income tax, due to incorporation, we don't necessarily need to be arguing that any incorporation which reduces income tax is a bad thing. But the further that we're seeing incorporation on its own associated with that income tax fall, rather than any wider economic growth impact, the more we think the quality of incorporation in the aggregate is a problem. You can, you know, then go to different types of corporate entities and say that something like Scottish Limited Partnerships is, of course, much more likely to be associated with particular forms of abuse because of the lack of transparency and so on with it. So you can get a bit more granular. But I think it's probably not helpful to think that you really want to say sheep and goats here. You need to be thinking about the overall quality of incorporation to understand what your stance as a policymaker should be in terms of how you might want to limit it overall, rather than how much you might want to go after an individual bad guy, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I would just say, even if all incorporation was good incorporation, if operating a business in that way meant you got less tax of a certain type, then you know that's got to be made up somewhere. So there's an issue at UK level as to where it would be made up, and there will be an issue at Scottish level as to whether that solution works, you know, given the pattern of devolved and non-devolved powers and the block grant and so on. So I think there would be an issue, even if it was all good. I agree with Alex's comments that it's very difficult to segregate 100% good, 100% bad. It's a bit of a spectrum. I don't think you'll get, you know, hard and fast facts, partly for definitional problems as to what's good and what's bad. But I think if you look back at some of these analyses and you see a big spike in company corporations when there was a 0% rate of small companies corporation tax, or if you notice that the trend accelerates as the corporation tax rate has been coming down and promised to be reduced further, you can get a feel, which is, you know, sometimes as much as you get that you have to base policy on. You very rarely have perfect information at any one time. So I think there is enough to say that it's, in any event, an issue for the tax base, and that obviously some of it is to some degree tax motivated, and you know will vary in amount according to what signals and what rates are changed.
But that doesn't make it the wrong thing to do. And this is a problem, that it seems to me there's an awful lot of subjective assessment of whether this is a good or bad thing driven by what is the ultimate income tax take, whereas actually that's coming at it from the wrong end. Surely what should be driven is the right model, whether it be self-employment, incorporation, employment, for the outcome for the economy. And that's just the final question I want to put up, and I'll do it very quickly, which is simply around, isn't the solution less to be doing something with what is, to my mind, a very blunt instrument of tax, and much more around, a number of you have alluded to IR35. And it sounds to me that the disguised employment that Richard Murphy's talking about, it seems to me that what you are suggesting is the IR35 legislation is not working sufficiently to pick up illegitimate, if you like, disguised employment. And so surely rather than using a blunt instrument, a tax, to force a behaviour change, you simply tighten up the IR35 legislation.
Discussions for years about tightening up IR35, mm-hmm. and you need a bigger HMRC to police it if that's what you really want to do.
But if it's the right thing
to do. Coming back
to
your earlier part of your question, would I pick it up correctly to suggest that really the issue is not how you police it or whether tax is directing it, but more you should be looking at whether there's differences in tax, because the drivers of this are that you've income tax, corporation tax, and national insurance come in at different rates. So if you manage to level those out more, there would be no incentive to go one way or the other, and then you could pick the true economic vehicle that you wanted for your business for other reasons.
Yes. And that's why I suggested you need to look at having a new type of incorporation for the 21st century, because we've just got the wrong tools available to us. The choices for businesses at present are simply wrong. We're forcing people into the wrong models.
Okay, thank you very much. That ends that session. I'm very grateful. We've covered a lot of ground there, some interesting ground, and a lot for us to consider. Again, thank you very much. I close this session of the committee.